I am Boyd D. Clements, 217 North 2nd Street, P.O. Box 245, Elmwood, Nebraska, 68349. My age will be 78, the 20th of February, 2003. I recently went through my old military records and memorabilia for a church service and dinner to honor all war veterans. My kids seemed to be quite interested, so I thought I might go through them and tell what I can remember on video. After looking at old pictures and orders, it does bring back a lot of old memories. I turned 18 in February 1943 and had to register for the draft. In order to pick my branch of service, I decided to enlist in naval pilot training. They required 3 letters of character reference.
The first letter was from Dr. O.E. Liston, M.D., Elmwood, Nebraska, February 12th, 1943, to whom it may concern. This certifies that I have known Boyd Clements all his life. He is a fine, clean, energetic, honest young man. His health is excellent. I unequivocally recommend him for the position which he is applying. O.E. Liston, M.D. Man, I didn't know I was that good. The second one is from Green's Drug Store, established 1886, prescription and pharmacist. T.H. Green and Ralph W. Green, to whom it may concern, February 12, 1943. The bearer, Boyd Clements, is well known to me and is a young man of good personal habits, hard time reading it, honest and has a good deal personality, a great deal personality, and is able to apply himself. He comes from a good American family and is a loyal citizen. Ralph W. Green, registered pharmacist. This letter I really treasure. It's from Bestreeter Aldrich, the well-known author from Elmwood, Nebraska, who wrote a lot of prairie-type books and is very well-known. She's gone now, but we were very good friends with her family, and she was a very good friend of my mom. Bestreeter Aldrich, The Elms, Elmwood, Nebraska. February 11th, 1943, to whom it may concern. This is to certify that I have known the bearer, Boyd Clement, since his birth, and that he is of excellent character. Respectfully, Mrs. Bestreeter Aldrich. Several of her, she had a lot of books. One of them, Miss Bishop, was made into a movie. And she wrote a series of Christmas stories. Some of those were made into movies also.
My Navy career really ended before it got started. I was accepted, and they sent about, I can't remember, 6 or 8 of us into Omaha to the Naval Recruiting Station to be sworn in. They had us lined up in the room up there to take an oath to get in. And somebody come out of the back room and says, "Hold it up." He says, "They've canceled that V-12 program." I think that's what it was, if I remember right. So they says, "Sorry, boys, head for home." And that was the end of that. Looking back at that experience, lucky it turned out that way, because I get seasick and I'm afraid I wouldn't have made a very good naval pilot off of a carrier or something if that's where I would have ended up. So I definitely wanted to get into flying, so then I beat it down to the Army recruiting station and enlisted in the Army Air Force. I'll show you my papers on that.
Recruiting and Induction Section, Headquarters, 7th Service Command, Omaha, Nebraska. Each of the following named privates, Air Force enlisted reservists, air crew, having been found qualified for aviation cadet appointment is ordered to active duty and will proceed from the address indicated after his name to 224 Post Office Building, Omaha, Nebraska, reporting to the district recruiting officer no later than 3 p.m., 7th of June, 1943, and then will proceed from Omaha, Nebraska, to the Army Air Force Basic Training Center, Shepherd Field, Texas, for pre-aviation cadet training. A few of the names on the list that were with me were David Alfrey from Louisville, Robert Breckenfield from Omaha, who has relatives buried at the Elmwood Cemetery, very good friend of John Campbell from Sioux Falls, South Dakota, of course, Boyd Clements, and let's see, I forgot, John Bloomer from Lincoln, and Bill Fenton, there he is, from Lincoln. He was later in an air guard in Lincoln and crashed in a jet and was killed south of Lincoln after the war. There's one more name I just noticed. I don't remember him. Roy Stubendick, Unadilla, Nebraska. Some of this is kind of interesting. It says, in lieu of transportation and subsistence allowance en route, the FD will pay each of the above-named Air Corps enlisted observers travel allowance, 5 cents per mile from the address indicated to his name to Omaha, Nebraska, to be paid on arrival at the training center. Item 3, government transportation and meal tickets for 4 meals plus 2 extra meal tickets for procurement of necessary meals in cases of unavoidable delay en route at a cost of not to exceed $1 per meal if served in a dining car and not to exceed $75 elsewhere will be furnished each man named in this letter by the Omaha District Recruiting Office.
After we got up to the recruiting headquarters, they sent us out to, well, at that time it was Fort Crook, to be shipped down to Shepherd Field, Texas. And in the evening, they had us lined up out in front of one of the big buildings there at Fort Crook and telling us all our rules and regulations and so forth and where we're going, what we're going to do. And some kids smoked and flipped a cigarette butt down on the ground. And that was our first introduction to the Army. This sergeant came unglued. He ate us out from one end to the other. And our whole group had to spend about an hour policing the area, and they taught us how to field strip cigarettes and throw them away. Needless to say, our group missed our supper and didn't get anything to eat till the next breakfast on the train. From Omaha, we took a troop train, to Wichita Falls, Texas for basic training. Omaha to Wichita Falls. Don't have too much from basic training. I have a few photographs. I'll show them to you. This is me in front of the barracks. As you can see, our uniforms didn't fit too well. There I am with a gas mask on in this picture. That's a picture inside of the barracks. As you can see, there's a card game going on over there in the corner. That's the picture of the barracks that I stayed in, right there. That's a picture of the mess hall. And they called it service center, but it didn't amount to much of a service center. This guy's name was Jones. He was from Iowa. I don't remember quite where, but he's taking care of two things at one time, writing letters home and taking care of business all at the same time. I said before, I don't remember an awful lot about basic training, except it was hot and dirty and so forth. And remember when we first got our uniforms issued down here, went through this big building down the line, and they'd look at you and throw you out a pair of shoes and a shirt and pants and so forth. And the only thing you could argue about was your shoe size. You could go try them on, and if they didn't fit, you could get changed. But the rest of them you lived with. And next thing probably is you started learning about inspections, especially in barrack inspections. And you'd have to, somebody, officer would come in, they'd call attention, and you had to stand by your bunk and have everything, your things out for inspection. And they'd drop a quarter on your bed. If it wasn't tight enough to bounce the quarter, why, you're in trouble. And I remember the old GI shoes, the high-top GI shoes they issued us. Everybody had to take GI soap and a big old scrub brush, and we scrubbed them for a day or two until we got all the paint and polish off of them, and then they would take a good shine, and they had to be shined perfectly, even after you had marched in them all day. You had to get them ready for the next day's inspection. Remember our first payday, I don't know how many thousand of us were lined up at the headquarters building or pay office, and sitting in the hot sun waiting for your turn. And finally, after an hour or two, when you finally got there, I went in and I'd been redlined, and I said, "Sorry, but you didn't put your full middle name." And I said, "I don't have a full middle name, I only have the initial D." But that was too bad, so I had to wait till the next 2 weeks before I got paid, and I got caught up then. After that, I put IO, which is initial only, above my middle initial. The drill field was a humongous thing. I don't know how, like a mile square or something. It probably seemed awfully big to me, but it was very large. And wind would blow, the dirt would blow. It was completely, there's nothing but dirt and dust. And as the dust would erode the ground away, it was rocky too. And there'd be all these rocks laying around that you have a hard time marching. So every now and then they would call a halt, and they'd have an army of men, looked like a mile wide. We'd have to march the full length of that thing and gather up all the rocks, and then they'd stop you, and you'd have to all put your rocks down. So they had these big lines of rocks so that they'd go in the machinery and pick them up for the next day. And we really marched and drilled till we thought our feet would fall off, but we always had to have our gas mask on when we were taking drill instructions. And it was hot, and you'd have those gas masks on, and you'd sweat and steam in them. And some of the guys got smart. There's a rubber flapper in them. They found out they could take that rubber flapper out of them, and they could breathe pretty good, and they weren't nearly as hot. But it was always, I guess that nobody would ever say anything, but it always happened to the new groups that came in. One day we were marching, and they marched us over to the gas chamber and marched everybody through that gas chamber. And I'm telling you, those guys that had the flappers out of them come out of there spitting and sputtering. They put them back in and never took them out again. Of course, we took calisthenics there every day, and they got us in pretty good shape. But it was a little bit different than I had been used to. But they'd always take, after you got done with calisthenics, you'd take a road run clear around this base out perimeter, and I think it was like 4 miles or more. And a lot of them bit the dust along the way, and they'd have to go haul them in. But at the one end of the, about halfway around, there's a big sewer ditch come out of the base, and I think it was just for the base, but it had big sloping sides down to it, and you had to get across that thing. Well, I'd been out for track at the University of Nebraska before I got in. I was in pretty good shape. I could usually jump it, but I'd say about half of them could make it part of the time, and a few of them made it all the time, and some of them didn't even try. They'd just wade across with their shoes on. That night they had to get them dried out and all repolished and stuff, and they smelled, and It never changed, that they had to wade through it every day that we went around. In the mess hall one time, I don't know, a lot of us started getting diarrhea and weren't feeling good, and so they had quite a checkup, and they finally found out that their dishwashers weren't working right, and they weren't getting the old soap off of the mess trays that we had. They got that cleaned up, and we all got better. I do remember that one day we went in, and they had this good-looking meat. It was kind of pink, and even the fat around it was pink-colored, but they said it was, told us it was horse meat. We could eat it if we wanted to, and I ate some, but it wasn't too bad. It was kind of stringy. But some of the city boys, they thought they were really pretty hot stuff, you know, and us little country kids, we were kind of sitting around in the corners, but they had card games going all the time, and the barracks chief, each barracks had a barracks chief. He had a little room in the corner, but he played poker with them and stuff the whole time we were there. They'd win and lose and win and lose, and just before we shipped out, we all got paychecks, and sure enough, the barrack chief even invited them into his quarters to play, and they played most of the night, and lo and behold, the next day we had a few guys hanging their heads of hot shots from the city, played cards all night, and somewhere or another the barracks chief ended up with all their money, and they were broke and headed for shipping out with not a dollar in their pocket. They look over the cards, and they finally figured out that he had had marked cards, but he cleaned them out, but there's nothing they could do. We were gone the next day, and so was their money. A few of them kind of hung their heads, but several of us loaned them a buck or two to get them through till the next payday at the next station.
From Shepherd Field, Texas, we were shipped by troop train to Logan, Utah. That's where Utah State Agricultural College is. And we arrived there July 26th of 43, and we left October 7th of 43. From Shepherd Field to Logan, Utah. While there, we took mathematics, physics, history, civil air regulations, medical aid, military training, physical training, and we got our first flying. We got 10 hours in a Cub, Piper Cub, J3 Cub. Nobody was allowed to solo there.
When we roll into Logan, Utah, after basic training in Shepherd Field, Texas, and the heat and the dirt, we really all felt like we were kind of in paradise. Logan is located in the kind of the valley at the end of a big canyon called Wind Canyon in the mountains there. I think the altitude, if I remember right, is around 5,000 feet. There's a big mountain stream comes down this canyon and goes right by Logan. And they went up the canyon a long ways and built a big water aqueduct up along the side of the mountain, along the canyon wall. And it didn't have as much fall as the stream, so when it gets to Logan, it's sitting clear up on the side of the mountain there. So they have this fresh water, mountain water, that they run down through Logan for irrigation for the ag college. And the city of Logan is kind of built on a long street, and the streets in Logan have gutters, and they run water down these curbs 24 hours a day, and everybody has a little floodgate in front of their home, and they can open this little floodgate and water their gardens or yards or whatever they want. It's a beautiful place. And in this stream, there's a lot of fishing. There were several dams built on it, and not real large dams, but just enough to make some beautiful mountain ponds. And you could get up on the side hills there and just see the great big trout down in there and fish. And the world record brown trout was caught there. I do remember that. Some of the guys would sneak out at night, which really was a no-no in cadets. If you got caught, you're in big trouble. They'd sneak out and go in the fruit orchard and come in with apples and whatever was happening to be in season at the time. And we moved into a brand new girls' dorm. I guess it's been the guys ahead of us, but the girls never did get moved in it, and that was our barracks. And that was something pretty nice. You'd see the big cars come down out of the hills, monstrous cars. I don't know, the big old Packards or something, but there'd be a whole family of about looked like a dozen kids in there. They always said that those Mormons had several wives, and I believed it after that. This is an aerial view of the campus there. It was really laid out nice. It had this great big grass area. Quadrangle, they called it, with the sidewalks going across, and all the main buildings were built around that square. And this, of course, is the main building right in front, and I think that's the library in back, and some other building. But then the smaller buildings were built in back of that. But it was really nice. This is a picture of our squadron taken in the bleachers at the football field. Used this quadrangle right there at the campus to do all our drills. We did a lot of marching and close order drill there. And sometime while you were there, they halted this whole group and singled you out. And you had to go out and stand in the middle of the place and march all four squadrons around, clear around that square. And I'll tell you, you're shaking your boots, but I got through it. A lot of the guys that have them marching into trees and everything, but I got them clear around and stopped, so I lucked out there. We did finally get some uniforms that fit a little better when we got up to Logan. This is what we'd all been waiting for, getting in an airplane. As I said before, we all got 10 hours. We couldn't solo, but it was quite an experience. Being this is up in the mountains at high altitude and gusty winds, all your flights were very rough. Now and then the wind would come down this canyon, storm would come up, and I wasn't ever up when it did that bad. But when I was out there and watched them sometime, the wind was blowing so hard, they would fly those cubs in and almost come straight down with them into the wind. It'd head them into the wind, and they'd almost come straight down. And there'd be about four guys out there, and they'd grab the wing struts as soon as it got down to the ground, and they had to walk them back into to tie them down so they didn't blow over. There's another shot. That's a different cub there. This is a shot of my pilot log. I only had 10 hours in it, but it was a lot of fun. I've kind of forgotten my serial number as an enlisted man, but it looked like 374800089. I got a new one when I was discharged when I got my wings and got a commission. I was discharged as a private and went back in as an officer and got a new serial number. And I remember that one, 0-784858. Had to use that a lot.
This is a copy of the certificate I got when I left Utah State Ag College. That was 9th of October, 1943. This is another view of the campus from one cub. There's a cub in the picture. But this is the campus, and you can see Wind Canyon where it starts right back up there and goes on up into the hills. If you look real closely, this is water. Aqueduct comes along up here, and then that's where it comes down and dumps into the stream down here, and it's carried down into the campus and into the city of Logan. This is the front of the girls' dorm where we stayed. When we had time off, we were always climbing up in the little mountains around there. This is horsing around. I think that's Bill Fenton and John Bloomer pretending like he's about to slide down the mountain and he's saving him. Those guys are both from Lincoln. Bill Fenton, I guess maybe I said, was killed in a jet crash. He joined the Air Guard in Lincoln, and he was killed south of Lincoln in a jet crash. And this is another guy I got quite friendly with. His name was John Campbell, and he was from Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Should try to look him up and see if he's still alive. Of course, we took a lot of phys ed up there, and that was a real rude awakening. The first time they got us out there on the football field and then put us on the track, and I don't know how far they told us to run, but what I mean, that altitude was a shocker. We finally kind of got over it before we left, but we're not really completely. Yeah, we did have an obstacle course there, too, that we had to run every day, or every time we went out for phys ed. Like I said, we did finally get some better fitting clothes, and we had to look sharp all the time or we were gigged, and that didn't help your chances in cadets. There's one last shot of Logan Canyon. You can see that beautiful stream, and there's the water aqueduct coming right down. Right up there again. I remember the last part of it, they tunneled through the mountain there. And down here, I think, if I remember right, that was their water treatment plant for drinking water. Cadet training at that time, they were really tough on us. I mean, just, we called it chicken shit stuff, but boy, they were really after you. We had a sergeant in charge of our dorm there, or the girls' dorm. His name I'll never forget is Sergeant Provisano. And I know one night we stayed up all night with toothbrushes scrubbing the floor in that place. And I met up with him later on. I'll tell you about that when I get there. I think that was at Kingman, Arizona. Okay, when we left Logan, we were shipped down to Santa Ana, California, from Logan down to Santa Ana, which is in Orange County, just outside of L.A. That was for classification. We took all kinds of tests, and they classified you either a pilot, a bombardier, or a navigator, or you got washed out. We lost about half of the cadets right there at classification. Santa Ana, it was kind of 3 months of really stressful because you'd gone so far and you knew what was at stake here. You knew that a high percentage of the guys would be washed out.
plus you might not get your shot at the thing you wanted to do, was being a pilot, navigator, or bombardier. Of course, I wanted to be a pilot, and that doesn't always happen. That's the reason for all the tests. We had about 3 months of all kinds of tests and everything. I'll kind of mention a few of them. And also, if you worst out, with all the tests you'd taken, well, they knew pretty well what you were qualified. And the big story was, if you washed out, you were going to cook and baker school, and that was always the threat over your head. Of course, you had a good shot at gunner if you didn't make pilot, bombardier, or navigator. We talked to all different types of people, from shrinks on down, and they were just interview after interview, but they wanted to know everything about you. Of course, the main thing, they want to know whether you want to be a pilot, navigator, or bombardier, and why. And some of the shrinks would want to know everything about you, your sex life, your religion, and you name it. I mean, it was just one after another. And as you went to answer all these, you was trying to figure out in your mind how to answer them, what was going to do you the best, or what would hurt you the most. Of course, one question was, what kind of plane do you want to fly if you are a pilot? And before he let me answer it, he says, I'm just looking at you, you want to fly a P-38. And that was my dream, and that's where I was headed, out of advanced, until the P-38s didn't do quite as good in combat, and they were cutting back on them and getting more P-51s. So they closed, I think it was at Williams Airfield in Arizona where I would have gone, but they cut that program out, so that was the end of that. I don't imagine you can imagine how it would take 3 months to give you tests, but I'm telling you, they had buildings full of stuff and people asking you questions and taking exams. A lot of physics questions. A lot of times they would have drawings of gears on shafts with V-belts on them, and they'd show you which direction the gear was going on one end. They wanted to tell them what direction the gear was on the other end when it come out. They checked you on hearing to no end. They had night vision tests, where you'd put you in this dark room and flash a screen, and you'd supposedly see some little something, and if you didn't see it, why, your night vision wasn't very good. And they gave it to you two or three times, as I remember, and hopefully that you would improve. Well, I kind of caught on to it. If you kind of catch it out of the corner of your eye, you could see them better. And then afterwards, the three tests, I think it was, then they told you how to do it, and they checked you again to see how well you did, whether the ones that didn't get it could improve, or whether some of them didn't see them, never did see them. And they had machines and checks for peripheral vision, see how good you were at that. I mean, I guess that's quite an item, but I didn't suppose that people differed, but they must, because they sure tested you. They had pages and pages of true and false questions, and you take your best shot at them. You never know how you come out, but it must have been all right. Then they had one whole room of all kinds of dexterity things, like putting the square blocks in the round holes and the round holes in the square blocks and all that kind of stuff. But this whole room, you went clear around it doing all these things, and then they'd let you do them again and see if you could improve on them the second time you did them. But you spent hours in there on all this stuff. One of them that I really remember, it was in another room. They went in this room, and they had the whole room was lined with, looked like metal turning lathes. Well, they were, the bed and the motor and stuff. And what they did, they took a You had two handles, you know, on a metal turning lathe to control a cutting tool. And one handle turns it in and out, and the other handle turns it sideways, so you crank them to, when you're using a metal turning lathe. Rather than a workpiece up here, they had a flat, round disc. It just looked about like a old 78 turntable. And on that turntable, they had a round circle on, out towards one end, and it was copper. And in this tool holder, they had a copper wire that went out and would sit right on that brass button there, their copper button. And then they'd turn on the turntable, which would move around real slowly, and you were supposed to take turn the cranks and keep that wire on that copper spot. Well, that looked like a piece of cake, but they said, okay, go. And you grab those two things, what do you know? But they had left-hand threads on them. And I'm telling you, I was all over the place. Well, that man, I really flunked that one. But later on, we did talk to some guys that knew what was going on there, worked there and so forth. And they says, well, that's not really the case. They were wanting to know whether you were mechanically minded and done enough that kind of work that you knew the right-hand threads and left-hand threads, whether it normally go in or out. And so they said some guys that could do it pretty good, they knew they didn't have that ability. And of course, airplanes, everything was set up with to be done normally in bomb sites and whatever. So that kind of relieved my mind a little bit. We did have, I don't remember not a lot, but some written things we had to write, and that worried me the most because I'm a poor speller and that was not my cup of soup, but I give them a shot. Yeah, the old chicken shit stuff went on. I mean, I think they were pushing some of the older guys, they couldn't handle it, and they'd just give her up and blow their cork and go, but they kept pushing you all the time. Also, there they made you go down and get your hair cut once a week, so you're really trimmed up. It cost you, if I remember right, $1.50, and we got to timing them, and it was always between a minute and a minute and a half that they took to cut your hair when they'd have the guys in there, and they had a real racket going because I don't know how many thousand guys were there, and they raked in a lot of dough. Somebody was getting a good cut. Yeah, while we were there, we took a lot of PE. We played a lot of flag football. I mean, they kept us busy. And also, we did hours and hours of aircraft recognition. They'd put you in the dark room and have this screen up there and flash silhouettes of different airplanes, from Japanese and German airplanes, by the hour. And you had you sit in a chair and it had a little keyboard there, and you were supposed to punch the right keyboard for whichever plane went by. And I got to know them pretty good, but I couldn't tell you one of them anymore. I can't even remember the names of them anymore. I certainly wished I'd have done this 50 or 60 years ago, what I'm doing now, and I could have remembered quite a few details. I don't remember how long after we got done we had to sit around and wait for results, but I guess it came out all right for me. But we were really amazed at the guys that washed out that you thought were top notch, and but they didn't make it. So I guess they had the reasons for in their system for picking who they wanted to do what. But I got my classification as pilot, and I thank the good Lord for that one.
From Santa Ana, we went on down to Tucson, Arizona, and we went down there for primary flight training at Ryan Airfield. Ryan is right outside of Tucson. Going back to Santa Ana just for a second, I forgot that we did get to go into L.A. two or three times, and we thought we'd go down to see if we'd get into the Frank Sinatra radio show one night in Hollywood, and we got there, and there was like 2 blocks long of about 10 wide girls lined up and hollering and trying to get in, so we knew we didn't have a shot at that. And we did go to Coconut Grove, and that was quite a thrill, see that show there. By golly, I walked up to the bar, and I run into a guy from my hometown of Elmwood, who was Bill James. Kind of shocked him when I tapped him on the shoulder, but that's kind of one in a million shot. I'll start this out with a few pictures, just kind of give you the feeling where we were at. This is Ryan Field, and I counted something between 30 and 40 planes there. And you can see the mountains in the background. There's always several ranges of mountains, low mountains, but then they had all these valleys in between that were desert until they cleaned them off. The field here was one great big blacktop slab, and we'd land on one half of it and take off on the other half of it. There was a sweet little airplane. I just loved those. Sure would like to have one. Each class at Ryan, when you graduated, you got a booklet that shows all the crews and everything about the place. But we were class 44G. That means our class will graduate in the year 44, and we're the G class to go to get out, which would be in August of 44. Doesn't that look like fun? We were in Squadron 5. Of course, that's me. That's William R. Brand, our instructor. I want you to notice how big a man he is, about 300 pounds, I think. This is John Carroll. I got quite close to him. This is E.J. Cunningham. Now, he was a second lieutenant, and he transferred from some other division into the Air Corps to go through pilot training. This is Barr and Bill Barnett. I'd forgotten that John Bloomer from Lincoln went to primary with me, but I didn't see much of him because he was in a different squadron. But that's John Bloomer from Lincoln right there. This is a nice 8x10 photograph that we got of our instructor and our gang that he taught us how to fly. He was a big man. He had a little wife that weighed about, good looking little wife that weighed about 100 pounds. They invited us into this group into their house for dinner one night before we graduated. We had a graduation dance, and any of the people that happened to have friends or family close enough got to go to it. Of course, most of us didn't. The officers and cadets of the 11th Army Air Force Flying Training Detachment, Ryan School of Aeronautics of Arizona, request the pleasure of your attendance at a graduation dance honoring Class 44G to be given Friday, the 10th of March, at the Blue Moon Ballroom from 8 to 11:30 o'clock. Present for admission. Formal. This is Ryan PT-22 that's at the Confederate Air Force in Brownville, Texas, at the airport at Brownville.
Date of Orion PT-22, specifications. Wingspan is 30 feet. Length is 26 feet 10. Gross weight was 1825. Empty weight was 1278. Wing area is 134.25 square feet. Engine was a Kenner, It's 165 horsepower. Performance maximum speed was 128. Cruise speed 116. Landing was 54. Rate of climb 680 feet per minute. Surface ceiling was 14,800. Its range was 325 miles. Took a crew of two. The instructor flew from the rear seat. The student was in the front.
Another kid and I tried to see how high we could get with ours one day. I bested him a little bit. I got a little over 13,000, but ours were pretty tired in those days. Try it one more time. Sorry about that.
Okay. This is Ryan PT-22, recruit. Came from the company that produced the Spirit of St. Louis and the first low-wing trainer of over 100 horsepower to be accepted by the Army Air Corps. And it gained the PT-22 primary trainer. The PT-22 was a descendant of the famous ST-1 sport monoplane. 22s featured a 65 horsepower radial engine that provided outstanding climbing ability. It had an excellent rate of roll performance that brought acceptance by the U.S. Army Air Corps in 1941. Thousands of pilots took their first flight in the PT-22 and then graduated to the BT-13, 15, or AT-6 advanced trainers. This BT-22 is furnished in the original pre-1942 paint theme and markings. Only 1,048 of the BT-22 aircraft were built. 25 served with the Dutch Air Force as training and scout aircraft. This 22 flies with the Confederate Air Force Training Command as it did with the AAF in the late 1930s and throughout World War II. Yep.
Ryan Field was just outside of Tucson, Arizona. And I don't know whether you've ever heard of Old Tucson. It's a kind of a tourist trap attraction of old Western buildings and stuff. But at that time, it had been an old movie set. And all there was this old half adobe wall sticking up there. But it was right near it. We'd take off and we flew right over it. Very close to where Ryan Field was. We, of course, came from the train station out to the Ryan Field in an old Army school bus type, and the closer we got to it, we were hanging our heads out the window and looking, and sure enough, we could see all these little planes up in the sky. The closer we got, it just looked like a bunch of bumblebees buzzing around, and what I mean, we were all pretty much excited kids, and thinking that we were going to be part of that pretty soon. The old chicken shit stuff never did cease, but you were supposed to conduct yourselves as officers and gentlemen, of course, in that training. And first night at mess hall, it was set up pretty nice. They had long tables and of course, you had your mess trays and stuff, but now I'll take it back. Maybe we had dishes there. I can't remember. But anyway, you marched in and stood attention and sat down together and everything. And then the cooks or somebody brought food in bowls and served it to you. And they'd set the bowl down and send it around the table, and everybody would take their fair share and go from there. But, well, all the guys got in there and we were all hungry. Of course, I was down at the wrong end of the table, and they started the bowls around, and probably about a third of us didn't get anything to eat. The rest of them had taken it all. We sat there a little while, and I don't know, we started complaining a little bit, and that was a no-no. The sergeant that was in charge there, he let us know that you don't do that, and cadets, and gave us the business. Well, I think maybe if we'd have shut up, they would have brought us some food, but we said something, so believe it or not, we were on KP the first night in there. We went all night till breakfast without anything to eat. And I'll tell you, after that, everybody dished out food and was pretty careful with it and got it around and then kind of divided up from the rest of the time we were there. Each instructor down at Ryan had five students, and instructors were civilian. Our instructor was W.R. Brand, and he weighed 300 pounds, if he weighed a pound. I mean, he wasn't any taller than I am, but he could barely wiggle into that cockpit when he got in. And he was a very nice gentleman, all, and I really enjoyed him. And believe it or not, after, I don't know how many, I've forgotten how many hours, but he said, okay, take it around, you know, for my solo flight. And I was the first one out of the of our five, which made me kind of proud. But anyway, boy, I wheeled her out there and took off, and we just made a circle around the field and land. I took off, went around the field, made my base leg approximately where we'd been making it, well, distance out from the field as we'd always been doing, and cut the old engine, started gliding by glide path, and boy, the old thing was just floating like a kite up there, and I was probably, I'm just guessing, 300 feet high. The pattern was 500, and I was probably down to about 300 when I should have been on the ground. And so, well, what do? I poured on the gas, went around again, and this time I went way out farther on my base leg, and well, this'll do her. And cut the power, and here I come, and that time I was, I'm guessing, 100 feet over the field. I looked down there, I could just see him laughing his head off down there. And the third time I went around, I went way out, flew her down to the cactus, crossed the fence, and cut the throttle, and come in and taxied in, and he was just really having a ball. He says that happens to every one of his students, the first one at solos. He says, I was just getting ready to go get the shotgun and shoot you down. Now, I'll try to remember a few instances here, that interesting things, that the things that I remembered, so they must have stuck in my mind. I don't remember much anymore, but we'd get check rides, and they had an officer on the field, or two, I believe, two pilots that were officers that gave the check rides. But they were Army pilots. They weren't very happy about being there doing that. But anyway, I don't know. Never figured it out to this day, but he took me up. I did a few, did all the things I was supposed to do, the aerobatics and whatever. And he says, all right, he rattle that, he has, a lot of those guys will rattle that stick between her leg and just wrap you in the leg. And he says, I got her. And he was not very high altitude. I wish I could remember. I know at the time he did it, it was really low. But he did hammerhead stalls, if you know what those were. He'd dive it and get it going real fast and then pull it up and go straight up in the air, and it would drop straight down on his tail. And then he'd pull it out. But he was dangerously low, and he did about a dozen of those. I don't know whether it was purposely to see if he could make me sick or make me say uncle or what, but I sat there and held my breath and got all done with that, and he said, I'll take her back, and we did, but he got out and never said a word. And but that was one I'll never forget. And we were, of course, after we soloed, we were out flying around all by ourselves all the time, and there was a big railroad bridge out in the desert that went over a little stream, and every place you went, there was always something the guys had going that you weren't part of the gang until you did it, but if you got caught, you took that chance of getting washed out of cadets. Well, I worried about that more than anything, so I never did do it, but one day the base commander got a letter from the railroad or a telephone call, and he says, you're going to have to quit using that railroad bridge for training, he says, because we're going to put scaffolding under it. But the guys would get wet watch and make sure there's nobody around, and then fly under that railroad bridge, which wasn't very high and wasn't very wide. But that ended that for sure. Time we'd go to the mess hall in the morning, and when you left, they always, a lot of times they had fruit for you to take out, and they had oranges there. Real strange, but the oranges would all disappear. Everybody would take a couple or three and put them in their flight suit, down in the leg pockets in their flight suit. And we'd get up and we'd go out in the desert, and we'd find some farmhouse or ranch house out there, and a lot of them had, weren't real plush, you know, and they'd have outside toilets, so we'd take turns getting two or three of us in a row, and we'd dive down and dive bomb and try to hit them with oranges when we went by. Now and then we'd get somebody to run out of them, but not too often. After I soloed, wasn't too long after, man, I thought I was the hottest pilot in the country, and I had been up for a flight, and I landed it and taxied in and whipped it into a parking stall, or it lined them up in rows, I guess you saw in that picture earlier. I whipped it in there, and I ground looped that puppy, went around, clear around and back around, and I don't know whether nobody saw me or what, but I never heard about it, but I came very close to wiping out two other planes beside mine, but boy, I got that thing parked, and I got out of there right now. We had another test pilot that took me up for a check ride, and the old Ryans, you didn't have any communication except they had a little funnel up in the front, and just a tube went back, to you had a headset on, and it was just actually hoses came back, and he'd talk into that funnel, and you could hear him pretty good. But this guy that took me up for the test ride had me do all the maneuvers and aerobatics and the whole bit, but the whole time he sat up there with his hand outside of the cockpit drumming that funnel on the side of the plane and the wind blowing in it, and they did everything they could to give you a hard time, it seemed like. I guess maybe I mentioned before that another kid and I, we made up our mind we got way out, see how we could get those little things, and I bested him a little bit I gave up, but I mean, I was over 13,000 feet with that little old thing, and but they were pretty tired, some of them, but that looked, you can see a lot of distance from up there. We was always trying something. And, like I say, we really never learned how to fly until we started aerobatics, and that was really, you learn the plane and how to get out of stalls, and you'd stall it 100 times, and you just, it was a good way to really learn, and that's when I felt that I really had learned a lot with the aerobatics. Anybody can take it off and fly it straight, a little harder to land it, but really to understand flying and the plane, that the aerobatics does it. The time we were there, we'd get to go into Tucson now and then, and at that time it was only 40,000 people, just kind of like a little cow town down there, and we enjoyed it. There was a Blue Moon Dance Hall. It was kind of a hangout for cadets and women that were around and Tucson, but that's about the only place to go, and we did go there quite a bit, and that's where our graduation dance was held. Let's see, what else? Oh, when we did graduate, they lined us up, we were all at attention out on the field, and they had the governor of Arizona come out and give us a little speech. Well, about that time the wind came up and the dust and dirt and sand was blowing, and he was telling us, all us guys, that when you get out of the service and come home, he says, we want you to come back to Arizona, to the land of enchantment. Well, we really hooted and thought that'd be the last place on earth that we'd ever want to go back to, but we should have gone back and bought some land right after the war, because it sure did grow. It was pretty darn, I guess one other thing I thought about, it was pretty darn cold, and we wore those old leather flying suits with sheep line flying suit, big old heavy clumsy things, but I'll tell you, it got pretty darn chilly some mornings when it was about down to freezing and out there in the desert, and you were riding in that back cockpit, the old wind really whistled through there. Of course, all these places we were at, we took a lot of ground school at the same time. I mean, we were taking classes when we weren't flying. And PT or physical education, and still did a little bit of drilling, not a lot anymore after we were in flying, but we did some. I don't know what happened to all those Ryans, but I suppose they scrapped a lot of them. But I did see three or four of them at the Oshkosh at the air show there, and then this one down here at Brownville. But I really fell in love with that plane. It would really be nice to have one. While we were there, maybe you noticed on that windsock booklet we got from there, that booklet was dedicated to Edward J. Healy. He was the one cadet that was killed while I was there. As you can see, I fell in love with the cadet haircuts too. I've worn them all my life, except for when I was courting my wife. And I guess it worked out, because she's the best thing that ever happened to me since the service. And then after I got her hooked, well, then I started shaving it off again.
This folder contains all the flying records, my hours and so forth, from the time I started primary until I was discharged. This is at Ryan Field at Tucson, where we're still talking about. It shows PT-22, I had 195 landings. Student dual time, 29 hours and 11 minutes. And student first pilot time, 35 hours and 49 minutes. And instrument training in the link trainer was 5 hours and 5 minutes. So that was a total of 65 hours and 10 minutes I had at Ryan.
We shipped out from Ryan. We really didn't ship out. We went by the regular old school buses again to Marana Field, which was north, about 30 miles northwest of Tucson. It wasn't a very long trip. If you go by there, you'll see there's kind of located by Picacho Peak, and it wasn't far from there. It was at a pretty large base, but we got in there on 11th of March of 44, and we left there on the 23rd of May, 1944. That's for basic flight training.
Don't have hardly any pictures and so forth, two or three here, but I saw this postcard I sent home. Never mentioned the big saguaro cactus. With our little planes, that was, we were worried about having to sit down with a crash landing or try to crash land them, because these suckers were all over. This is desert. The only place that was cleared out is where we had the airfields. And these are big old saguaro cactus. They would get as high as 50 feet high, and they'd live 200 years. But those suckers would tear up a plane. They were big and heavy. This is a picture of a BT-13, which we flew there in flight. Not very good, but I'll tell you more about the plane a little later on. This is some of our group in front of the planes that we flew. Basically, if you know what an AT-6 is, advanced trainer. This is the same, very similar plane, except it does not have a retractable gear, and it had a 450 horsepower engine, whereas the AT-6 had a 650 horsepower engine. I got to be front center there. There is John Camel, the only one still with me, I think, that I know of, buddy, right there. this is the group I trained with there at Marana. I don't remember what they called them, squadrons or what, but this is a gang of guys. And of course knew them all, but really was never real close to any of them. It seemed like we were awfully busy there. I do remember Willie Croslin, mainly because we heard later that he got through advanced and went to B-24s, and B-24 he was training in blew up and he was killed.
BT-13 was really a big airplane compared to what we'd been used to, Cubs and little Ryan PT-22s. It was a big, heavy metal airplane and two-passenger. And you walked up to that thing and you're a 19-year-old kid. Let's see, it was a 19 year, I guess so by then. It was something to look at and made you kind of wonder. We hadn't been to basic too long, and they called us all into a great big room, or our whole squadron. And they made the whole squadron count off 1 through 10, you know, 1 through 10, 1 through 10, until they all had a number. Then they said all of the 1 through 4s go to one side of the room, and all of them 6 through 10 go to the other side of the room. And they said, all right, gentlemen, they said, 1 year from today, according to the statistics, all of those on the 1 through 4 side will be dead. And so this is your last chance. We will let you transfer out if you want to, and to go talk to some guy. But they were kind of pointing out the statistics to us. But in those days, we were young, and we knew that nothing could happen to us. So I didn't know of anybody that disappeared that I knew of, but there could have been. Marana was quite a large air base and a lot of planes. I used to know the number, but it's in several hundred airplanes that they had. So we had quite a group in the air. And the flying field was the same as at Ryan, a huge square blacktop tarmac that you landed on one half of it and took off on the other side of it. And so there was a lot of traffic. This wasn't quite like the other primary. Here you had, didn't always get this, a lot of the times you'd get the same instructor, but from day to day you'd have different instructors. So they all taught a little different and had different ideas, and some of them were easy to get along with, and some were a son of a gun, so you really kind of had to stay on your toes. At Marana, I was the first one to solo out of our group, and the guy told me to take it around. And of course, there we had radios and everything, and so I taxied out to the end of the runway, and I called in and said this was 7's .05 or something, ready for solo takeoff. And the guy in the tower just chewed my butt, and he wouldn't quit because I says oh instead of 00, and he just kept at it and kept at it and kept at it, and finally he told me to take off. But after I got back, my instructor said he was on his way down there. He didn't know what was going on, why I wouldn't take off. You know, a lot of times they'll go out on a solo and they'll freeze at the end of the runway and won't go. But I took off and soloed all right. But boy, when I got back and told him what happened, he came unglued and he headed for that tower. And I guess he said he really read off that tower operator. He said, when I send a man out to solo and then you put him through that, why, But I guess it all came out all right. There's no repercussion from it. But I didn't ever say, anymore, I can tell you that. Now I'll just tell you some of the things that I remember. They won't be in any order or anything, but I just happened to think about the first cross country I took. The first triangular cross country. You'd fly out to one auxiliary field, fly to another auxiliary field, and then back to the base. They called it a triangular cross country. And so I took off and made it to the first landing field and landed. Everything went fine. And so I took off on the second leg to the second field. And I got up, and that old plane started missing and sputtering and coughing. It kept going, but it just kept, was really running rough and poking out a little smoke. And so I called into the base ahead, and they said, well, where I was, and I was closer to the second base, so they says, bring it on in. And I got there, and rather than fly the pattern like we normally do, they cleared the area and said, make a straight in approach. Well, I wasn't used to that, and I didn't know how far out I was and where to set my base leg, which I didn't have one. I came straight in, but sure enough, I was too high and got down there, and I was too high, so I had to go around, but I poured the cops to it, and it run fine, and I went on around and come back in and landed, and of course, I got chewed out on those. I had a canopy that just slid back. And you never made a landing without opening the canopy, because that was a no-no. I goofed there, because if it crashed or something, they would jam and they couldn't get you out of them. But I told them how bad it was running, and so they called back to the base and they wanted to know the plane number and so forth, and they said, well, that plane is not supposed to fly at that altitude. It's real tired, and the second leg was at a higher altitude, and they says, that plane won't run at that altitude. So they says, well, get in it and go on home then. They said, just stay down at the other altitude. So I went home, but a lot of those planes were really tired. So I was working in the engineering department at Goodyear Tire and Rubber in Lincoln after the war, and I don't know, I was in one day talking to the purchasing agent there, and I'd heard that he had been a pilot, so we were shooting the fat, and I told him I had been at Marana. Well, he had too, you know, and so we visited, and we talked about cross countries, and I said, well, the story they always told us there, before we took off on a cross country, I said, don't do like this one guy did that we had here. Said he took off, and he missed his first field, and he kept flying. He was got clear down into Mexico. He just wasn't smart enough to, I really was landing on, and he wasn't smart enough to turn around until he about run out of gas, and he finally set it down there someplace. And I says, then they had to go down and take it apart and haul it home. Found him, and this guy grinned, and he says, you know who that was? I said, no, and he said, it was me. So we had some kind of common bond there. That was a one in a million happening. Of course, we had radios there, and we used radio navigation with beams and so forth to locate yourself, but on your radio beams, they would give an A and an N signal. And then every so often that would break into that, and they would give some code letters of a station, and that's where you'd find your location. But anyway, we had to learn code. Boy, I had a tough time. I don't remember how many words a minute we had to take, but I really struggled with that, but I made it. I think it was 15 words a minute, something like that you had to take. But that was tough, and I'd lay awake all night trying to practice code in my head. Yeah, I guess I can talk a little bit about navigation now. Of course, the easy one was just to look at your map and find objects and cities and towns and so forth like that, and we did that. We did out a few times with instructors, and he would just see how we did. And he said, and finally, he said, if everything else fails, he says, find a village or a railroad track, and they'll always have a water tower on one of these little towns. Fly down and get the name off of the water tower. By chance, right there by Marana, there was a railroad went by there, and there was an old wooden water tower there, and so we buzzed the thing, and he says that's the way to do it, and read the name off of it. But I was by there just a few years ago on the highway, and sure enough, that old water tower was still sitting there. I couldn't believe it. I must be keeping it for a rally, because it was a wooden one right along the highway and the railroad track. Of course, nowadays they can just lock on to a signal, it'll point the compass, and all you do is follow it in. But in those days they had radio beams. They would send out a cross signal, and one of them would transmit an N, which is a dot dash, and the other one would send out an A, which is a dash dot. So where those beams, these sections in here would get together, where they'd come match together, then the A and the N would get together, and that would be a solid signal. So you could tell where these four quadrants were. You could fly into it and find one of them if you were an N section, and then go into that beam. And you could fly through that beam and make a turn and come back and follow the beam, get on the beam. You could keep going one side or the other and stay on that beam. And then you'd have to turn your radio down to, you could barely hear the signal, and keep flying that on that beam. And if the beam got louder, you're headed for the station. If you lost a signal, you knew you were going away from it. So if you're going away from it, you turn around and keep flying till you got into that station, and you'd fly in till you got right over it. And then you could look on your map and get the call letter of that station off your map, and you could find yourself on the map. And that's the way we located ourselves. That's the only navigation we had in those days. But that took quite a bit of practice on that. We'd go up and practice instruments and for an hour or so, and then they'd say take you home. But somewhere or another, the instructor would always get you out over the Gila Bend area, and that would really foul you up, because there were some kind of magnetic things going out there in the mountains that split up those radio beams, and they were split all to pieces, and they would really have a ball with you, because you just couldn't handle that one. On flying instruments, that was our first taste of it there. And of course we had link trainers that kind of started in there, where it was like a little airplane up on a pedestal, and you'd get in it and it would fly. You had the radio signals, you had everything, and outside of it was a guy on a desk with a machine that would track and plot your course exactly what you did. So they would make you go through this radio processes and flying the beams and bracketing them and coming in and then getting your heading for home and all that kind of stuff. Plus you could do your turns and stalls and spins and everything simulated in that link trainer. But then you would go out and you'd be in the back seat, and either instructor in the front, or as soon as we got a little more proficient at it, well, we'd take turns with different cadets in the front. And you'd go out and practice instruments like steep turns and everything else, and they'd always told us about vertigo, but we didn't know what it was, or didn't assume we would never get it. But it wasn't too long, and I was doing a series of steep turns and reversing them, and all of a sudden a darn seatbelt started tugging at me, and lo and behold, the gravel was flying up off the bottom of the old plane up at me, and what's going on? Well, I was clear over my back and didn't know it, and this kid, he was left there laughing, and the other was watching. But it's something that's real tough to get over, and to this day, I think at least 9 out of 10 of your small aircraft crashes. You see, are people that don't have instrument training, and they don't think that they can. They think they can fly anywhere, but they get vertigo and just crash and fly them into the ground. You can get a small sensation of vertigo a lot of times when you're just driving in the mountains and you lose the horizon, and maybe you're. Sometimes you think you're going downhill, but your old car's pulling down and you're going uphill. That's a very mild case of it. But it's a tough one to get over. In England we were flying, you would get it sometimes because a lot of times we were flying between two cloud formations with no horizon. They just blend together and you'd get it. And, well, you can shake your head and shut your eyes and a few things, but we were in tight formation and stuff, so maybe the other pilot would take over and you'd kind of get shut your eyes and get cleared of it, and then you're all right again. But it's dangerous and it's tough, and you've got, when you're flying instruments, you have to learn to believe the instruments and fight it, and you can do it, but it takes practice. That's why people that should keep very proficient on instruments that are doing any kind of flying. The other the pilot on our crew, Bert Ward, he was a little older, but and he knew it all, but he was a good pilot and a good crew commander, but he says, I've never had vertigo in my life. And one time we were coming back from a raid over Germany and we're letting down in England. I can tell you how we did that later, but we let down into that and we had to go down at a certain speed and a certain rate of descent. And all of a sudden he started veering off to the right and I hollered at him, Bert, where are you going? Bert, where are you going? And he shook that thing around and he got it straightened out, but I mean, we'd lost our approach, so we had to go up, back up through that, which was very dangerous. I'll tell you about that later. But after that, he didn't say he'd never had vertigo. While we were at Marana, they had a squadron of Chinese cadets over there learning how to fly. And one day it was pretty windy and the planes were coming in. This buddy of mine, he came in and set her down. There was a pretty good crosswind. This Chinese cadet, he came down and hit, about ballooned up in the air, and the crosswind picked him up and come over, and he come down right on top of my buddy's plane. The propeller cut the plane in two pieces right behind his head. And the plane set out on the field like that with the nose sitting up like that and the tail laying here. And my buddy was just about on the ground down here where this was at. Yeah, it was a close one, but they went out and got him out of it. Went out with a wrecker and picked up one half the plane, hauled it in, went out and picked up the other half and hauled it in. And they took him in and they put him in another airplane and made him take off again and have a little flight. I don't know whether anybody, I don't think anybody went with him, but they said that's the way they had to do it. They said if he'd sat around and thought about it, he probably wouldn't have ever flown again. But he got over it and went on through training and got through all right. One day we were all out taking phys ed there at Marana. We was kind of out over at the end of the field. And the pattern was, the base leg was right over and approached right over where we were taking phys ed. And the wind came up and switched. And I guess you understand this base leg deal. Like they were going to come in here and land. You fly down one side and then your base leg is over to where, and then you start your approach in. Well, it would always, it'd be a right hand or left hand pattern. They'd tell you on the radio what kind of pattern it was. So anyway, say this day they were coming in this direction and the wind changed and they changed it from they changed it from a right-hand pattern to a left-hand pattern. So she should be coming down this side and coming in here. And then, well, everybody that could understand English switched and were coming this way, and here come the Chinese cadets in the other way. You've never seen such a zoo in your life with those planes coming in at each other and peeling off and going all kinds of directions, but nobody, they all made it through it, but it was something to see. Of course, we did a lot of aerobatics here. And these were bigger, more powerful planes, and we were really enjoying them, but the only one problem with them, they had a gravity-fed carburetor, and you could do barrel rolls and loops and a few things, but you couldn't stay upside down but a little bit, and it wouldn't get gas and it would cut out, so that was always a problem as far as flying upside down for any distance. You had to, you couldn't hold her there very long, so most of our maneuvers had to be upside down for a little while. Every air base you went to, somebody figured out something to do that you shouldn't be doing. Right near Murano was, they called it Picacho Peak. It was a double set of peaks, and they had a red light up on each one of the peaks, and there was a huge wire that ran clear from one peak to the other, I guess for the light, but everybody says you were supposed to fly onto that. I never did see anybody do it, but they claim, a lot of them claim they were doing it, but I think they put those stories out just to try to get somebody to do it, but anyway, that was the one they had going there at Marana. Of course, all these places we were at, we were always taking all kinds of ground school, weather. We took a lot of weather, and even some first aid, and all kinds of flying theory and you name it, but they kept us busy, I'll tell you that. Because we were really a crash course for pilot training. One other thing I was thinking, the BT-13 was a real noisy aircraft. It had the gear on them stood pretty high, they stood up pretty high in the air. Like, one of the reasons for it was so they could have a large propeller on them. But if you change the propeller pitch to a low pitch for takeoff, I guess they had standard, they're automatic on some of those, but actually when you had that low pitch, they would wind up real fast, and the tip of this propeller would reach the speed of sound, and that's what made the noise. It wasn't the airplane engine and so forth, it was actually the propeller tips. And you look at every one of those propeller tips out there, and there's a million little fine hairline cracks right in the very outer edge of that propeller. And they said it was nothing to worry about, but they were caused by the speed of some of those tips reaching the speed of sound. To start the BT-13, they had a flywheel up under the cover there someplace. You'd get up on the wing, one guy would have to get a big crank he'd put in there, and you'd crank that and crank it until you get that flywheel turning, and then the pilot, he would engage it, and that flywheel would kick the engine over to start it. From Tucson, basic flight training, we went down to Douglas, Arizona, which wasn't too far for advanced flight training. From Tucson down to Douglas, which was right on the border. On the other side of the border was a little Mexican town of Agua Prieta. We went down there a few times, but there wasn't too much to do there. We got into Douglas on the 23rd of May and graduated from advanced flight school in August 4th of 44, and we got our wings in commission. I forgot to give the hours that I got at basic flight training. I had 126 landings. Student dual time, I had 28 hours and 35 minutes.
I had 30 minutes of night flying and student first pilot time. I had 37 hours and 20 minutes and 5 hours and 50 minutes night flying. I'd forgotten to tell you, we did get do a little bit of our first night flying there. So I had 78 hours and 59 minutes there. So my total flying hours are up to 137 hours and 15 minutes.
After basic flight training, you didn't know where you were going, whether you were going to single engine or multi-engine advanced. And I don't know whether the fact that I'd put in for P-38s were multi-engine maybe influenced where that I went to multi-engine advanced training or not, but I'm glad it ended up the way it went. So that was another thing that you were kind of on edge, wanting to know where you were going to go. At Douglas, that was the first field that actually had a runway like a regular airfield, not a huge tarmac, and it had lighted runway, not the best in the world, but it was lighted. And so from there we started flying, and there you didn't actually really solo. You went up with an instructor for quite a while, and pretty soon you were proficient, so you just started having other cadets fly with you, so there really wasn't any actual solo great big deal there. And multi-engine, we'd got our feet pretty well wet on flying, and multi-engine didn't amount to much, except we had to learn all the procedures for twin engines and all the procedures and emergency procedures for twin engines and so forth. That was a big deal of the actual flying skills that you learned there. Here at Douglas, we flew the AT-17s, which were stood for an Advanced Trainer number 17. It was built by Cessna, and it was they called it the Cessna Bobcat. Its nickname was the Bamboo Bomber because it had fabric covering on most of the plane, and it had a lot of wooden structure in it. It had two radial engines on it. Since I've been home, I've only seen two of them. One of them at Oshkosh at their big air show up there. And let's see, where was the other one? Oh, I think it was in some museum down in Tucson. But that's the only two that I know of at all. They weren't many of them kept, I don't imagine, because there had been an awful lot of maintenance on them, and everybody went for the metal airplanes, especially in the twin engine after the war. I don't know exactly when it was, but when we were there, one of the planes crashed out in the desert. Of course, both the cadets were killed, and for no reason. And we kind of hadn't, nobody told us, but they've been having a real problem. There was something like 18 cadets had been lost over a period of time, and with no real answers. They were just, they'd find them crashed and they couldn't figure it out. But this time they kind of got lucky because they found part of the wing about a mile away from the crash. And so they started digging into that. And the leading edge of the wings was formed with a thin plywood, and it was formed around the front edge of the wing, a curve clear around it, and I suppose soaked and formed, but anyway, then it was glued on to the wooden spars in the wing. Then of course the wing was covered with canvas, which went right over the plywood and formed the wing. But down there in the desert it was beastly hot, and the humidity, we took weather and it got down to almost 2% at one time. And what happened, the glue dried out on these wings, and that piece of plywood was actually loose inside the wing there. And when they were flying, if something put stress on or something and split that canvas a little bit, then the wind got behind that leading edge and it flew off, and of course that was, they were on their way down. It was almost instantaneous, they assumed, and that's why they didn't have any time to call in or anything. But they inspected all the planes then, and a very high percentage of them, that leading edge was absolutely loose, wasn't even fastened to the wing, but the canvas was holding it on. But needless to say, they did a little quick gluing and canvassing, and we were back in business. Another little problem was that plane, when you landed, you couldn't put the brakes on and bring it to a steady halt. You had to pump them just on and off and on and off all the way in, or it would get hot and you'd blow a tire every time. So that was, they really got after you that way. In fact, I still drive my cars that way. If it's good for an airplane, why, yeah, I think it's good for car brakes also. We started night flying down there. I don't know what kind of runway lights they had, but they seemed like they was kind of from the sides, and they were only about actually up in the air about 10 feet high. I mean, the beam themselves. And boy, it was tricky. You'd come in and it was an optical illusion or something. You'd try to land on the top of that light, and boy, when that thing paid off, you dropped her about 10 feet. And I'm telling you, you thought you were going through the runway, but it happened twice to me, but you finally learned how to do it. But they all had problems with it, and they warned you of it, but you still did it. Of course, it was hot down there, and you had little side windows, and you always had those open, and you even took off with them open. I don't know if it was a thing to do, but we did. And another cadet and I can't remember who it was now, but we started on a cross country. I think it was a triangular cross country. And I think we'd landed that the first one was taking off on the second one and starting to climb. And we would shut the windows after we got up and it got cooled off, but we were starting to climb, and I had the map and kind of held it out in front of me and across the steering column there. And all of a sudden it was just a great big whoosh of wind, and it went through that plane and took that map out the window, and we were on our own trying to go on this cross country. So we decided, well, there were several others on this cross country, so we poured on the cobs, and we got caught up with one place we could keep him in sight within 5 miles or so. We followed him around and got home all right. We didn't tell anybody, but I don't know what we'd done. We'd had to turn around and try to go home, I guess, if we hadn't caught up to that other guy. While we're there, one of the instructors I flew with quite a bit, and real nice guy. There were three instructors, and they each took a plane, and they flew to Salt Lake City for the weekend. I don't know, one of them had family or girlfriends or something there. But I guess on the way home, they were kind of just flying, not right close together, but within sight of each other. They could see this one guy, this guy I liked so well. Kind of started off a gentle downward path, and they headed and called on him in the radio, and he wouldn't answer, and they tried to catch up with him. They were going to try and put their wingtips under his and bump him and see if he was asleep or something, but before they could catch up with him, he flew right into the side of the mountain and was killed. As I've told you before, it seemed like every place had some stunt going on that you had to do it to be one of the boys. Well, I never did it, but I watched it done a couple times. Of course, it was very desolate land out in the desert down there, and you had to see these trains that you'd see them for going for miles across that desert. And it was all perfectly level, nothing around but cactus. And guys had watched till they could find a troop train down there. And they'd go down and get flying with the train right over it, and these things, you could put the flaps down and they would fly awfully slow. And they'd fly right down over that train and just keep edging down and edging down and edging down till they touch their wheels on the top of that troop train. Here are all the guys, you can see them down there hanging out of that troop train looking up at that plane about 3 feet above their head. But they did it, and I mean, it's something to see. But the guys were, they'd find something to do at every place that weren't supposed to do. Of course, Douglas was right down on the border, and we had an auxiliary field that was up, I remember, up north someplace there. Wasn't too far, but we went up, flew there, and we went over Warren and Bisbee. They're two small towns, and they were built right on the side, each side of the canyon. The cities went right up on the sides of it, and there were some huge copper mines there. I don't know, maybe the biggest ones in the United States, but anyway, this auxiliary field was directly beyond them a ways, and we'd go there, and I remember we'd shoot night landings and stuff over at that other field, and we'd come home, maybe at 1 o'clock in the morning or something, but we'd fly right down this canyon at housetop levels. I mean, you could look and see the houses and stuff right on either side of you. Then we'd pull our prop pitch to high pitch or low pitch, and they'd just wind up and make the worst racket you can possibly imagine. But I bet those people got sick of that, because it went on forever, because every cadet came right down that canyon. I don't know why they didn't stop us, but that's what was going on. And kids thought we thought we were having a ball. I guess we were. Agua Prieta was a little Mexican town just south on the other side of the river there. We went over a few times, but there are a few things that you could go do, but nothing that really amounted to anything. It was really a dirty little town, but we did go over and buy jewelry and silk stockings to send home. Of course, they couldn't get them in the United States, and that was kind of the big deal, but that's really all there was there. Well, then the big day came, August the 4th, and we got our wings and our commissions. We were sworn in as second lieutenants, and that was quite a good feeling to make feel like you'd really made it through all that and survived all the kids that got washed out and everything. And so you're immediately were officers and gentlemen, supposedly, but still only 19 years old. Was sent on our ways. At that time, when you were an enlisted man, they always sent somebody with you and carried all your orders and so forth. You didn't have your orders, but when you were an officer, then you immediately had to start carrying your orders from one base to the other. And so I should have some orders from each place now if I can get them all dug out. I'm going to see if I can find them from shipping from Douglas. When we got graduated, then we got to go home for a leave. That was the first time we'd been home since we got into basic training.
And this is my diploma from Advanced Flight Training, United States Army Air Force, Advanced Pilot School. Be it known that Boyd D. Clement, 2nd Lieutenant of the United States Army Air Forces, has satisfactorily completed the course of instruction prescribed for advanced pilot training. In testimony thereof, and by virtue of vested authority, I do confer upon him this diploma, given at Douglas Air Force Base, Douglas, Arizona, on this, the 4th day of August, in the year of our Lord, 1944. Commanding Officer Harvey Dyer, Colonel. This is my first set of travel orders as an officer. Headquarters, 3014th Air Force Base Unit, Pilot School Advance, Douglas, Arizona. Extract. The following name, Second Lieutenant, unless otherwise indicated, now at this station, are transferred to Kingman Air Force Base, Kingman, Arizona, for B-17 co-pilot training, 4th of August, 44, to arrive thereafter not later than the 16th of August, 44. 10 travel plus 10 days delay en route, reporting upon arrival to the CO for duty. That order was cut for just one person that way, because each one had different destinations and travel time and so forth. Okay, when I graduated from Kingman, when I graduated Douglas, I got some few days off, so I went home, spent a few days there, and then I headed for Kingman. Okay, Lincoln back out to Kingman. As you can kind of start to see on this map, I was assigned to the Western Flying Training Command, and the headquarters were at Santa Ana, California. So all my training was in that area. There was another headquarters down at San Antonio, Texas, and I think that was the Southern, but I think there was one in the East, but I only knew of those two that I was familiar with.
I really enjoyed the few days at home. That's the first we'd been home since we left home for basic training, and that was quite a long stretch of time for a kid, the first time he's been away in his life. A lot of kids got kind of homesick, but they did keep us so darn busy that you got over it. One other thing, when you got a commission, they didn't hand out clothes to you anymore, so you had to take your little bit of pay raise you got. I think we went to $150 a month from basic or privates for $50, and we got cadets for $75, and then we went up to $150 as officers. Anyway, we had to buy our own clothes. I had places on base where you could buy them and get fitted, so that was another nick out of your money. And of course, we all traveled individually when, as an officer, and got into Kingman and had to report in to the base headquarters, commanding officer, and you were assigned barracks and so forth. And first day there, one of the kids come in and he says, everybody's supposed to read the bulletin boards, and I read it, and I was assigned for flying the first night, if I remember right. I'm not positive, either the first night or the second night I was there, my name come up for a night flight. I couldn't believe it, but I'd never been close to a B-17 in my life. I had seen one once in the air before then, but that was it. And so that night I headed down to the flight line, and they told me, pointed out an airplane out there. So I went out there, and no pilot was there yet, so I kind of hung around there afraid to even get close to the thing, but they were loading a bunch of gunners in. Kingman was a big gunnery school, and it was a large gunnery school, and also they trained some bombardier cadets there at the same time, were getting training. And so I hung around there, and they loaded a bunch of gunners in, and here come this pilot, and he was really bent out of shape. I'm assuming because he was stuck at Kingman flying gunnery schools and flying fresh pilots out of just got their wings. So we crawled up in that big plane, and I sat down in that co-pilot seat, and I was just absolutely in awe. It had dials and gauges and lights all over that thing, and all the gauges had kind of a green coating on them, and then they had little blue lights that would make those gauges glow. And I just thought I'd gotten in over my head, but he crawled in there and he said, he threw me this checklist and says, read me the checklist, and I read it, and he pulled gadgets and buttons and everything, and he told me to start one, and I said, well, how does, and he showed me the switch, and he says, hold that switch until it starts. So I did it, and man, the whole thing belched and vibrated, and we got all four of them started, and he took off and climbed up to altitude, didn't say boo, and leveled off. I don't know how high, we were a couple thousand feet high, I'm guessing, I don't remember anymore. But he unfastened his seatbelt and started to get up, and he says, call me in an hour and a half, I'm going down and take a nap. And I started to plead with the guy, and he just says, you got your goddamn wings, haven't you? And I says, yes. And he says, call me in an hour and a half. Well, I'll tell you, that was a long hour and a half. And I never touched the throttles except to maintain altitude. And I did, made a great big circle around that airbase where I could see it out of my co-pilot side of the seat. And I don't think I even banked it and turns. I made the turns were gentle enough that I could skid it around the turns, and that's all I did, and held my breath for an hour and a half, and I told some guy to go down and get him. He come up, and he still didn't say boo to me, down and landed it, and away he went. And that was a really an introduction. I looked out to the wings. It was dark. You could hardly see them, and the little lights, red and the green light on the ends of the wings, and it just looked like a monster. I thought I'd was clear out of place, but it worked out. But I got to looking, I didn't realize it till the other night. I was going through my flying records, and he didn't even give me my flying hours for that flight. We took, it was hot out there too, and you get in that plane, and it was so beastly hot. Those guys would get in there for gunnery training, and oh, they would get sick. Take them on this flight, and when they got sick, they had to go up in the bomb bay. There's a catwalk through the bomb bay with kind of ropes where you could walk through there. That's where they got sick. They'd send them up there, and they could puke down in the bottom of the bomb bay. And when they got back, we'd open the bomb bay doors, and they had to all go back. The whole gang had to go get buckets and brooms and wash out those bomb bay doors when we got back. Pulled them. We had air-to-air gunnery and air-to-ground gunnery, where the airplane would pull a sock, and then we'd fly by, and they would all shoot at that sock. And of course, every tenth bullet or something like that was a tracer, so they could pretty much see how close they were coming, and it was good practice. They got pretty good at it. And then we'd fly real low to the ground, out over the desert, over the cactus, and they had objects set up out in the desert where we'd go by, and they'd shoot at these steel objects set down in the desert. We always said we were glad we were doing and not flying one of those tow planes for the target, because some of those guys were very good shot. One day at the base there, another guy and I were walking along on the base there, and here come this big squadron of cadets. They were bombardier cadets, and of course they took bombardier training there too, and with the Norden bomb sight, and went to school for quite a while. I don't know how long they were there, but here come this big squadron, boy, marching so neat and nice, and who should be in charge of this squadron but my old friend Sergeant Provisano from Utah. I recognized him. Of course, he was a sergeant and I was an officer then. I stopped that whole squadron and asked him if he remembered me. Well, I think he did, but probably not. But I kind of let him know who I was. And during this episode, while I was having fun, I looked back in the squadron and I spotted this kid kind of grinning back there. Lo and behold, it was Arlen Krause from my hometown. And he was just a year ahead of me in high school. And I couldn't believe it. So I still kept him. The squadron stopped and went back and talked to him. And found out where he was staying, what barracks was at, and then went over later that night and visited with him. But that doesn't happen very often, I'll tell you, that something that was one in a million. We didn't get a lot of flying hours, but mainly we took an awful lot of classroom study on the B-17, because there are all kinds of things to... Maybe I can look and see all the things that we studied, but it was a lot of classroom work. I think it was about 2 days before we left, a kid that was in my barracks there from Lincoln, Nebraska, Davis was his last name, was real friendly with him. They had to take a night flight, and I do not know what happened, but they flew into the side of the mountain, Frisco Peak. It's real, you can see it from miles around Kingman, and was killed. I went down to the base headquarters the next day and told him that I says he was from Lincoln and I knew him, and if there's anything I could do, that I was headed to Lincoln anyway. I wanted to go back with the body or anything, but they says no, go right ahead, because you don't know how long it'll be to get to the crash site and get it cleaned up. I was always going to go look up parents or something and the family, and I just never had it in me to do it when I got home. I suppose I should have.
I forgot to list my flying hours at Advanced Flight School. If I can read this right, student co-pilot time, 46 hours and 50 minutes. Student dual time, 24 hours and 25 minutes. Night flying, 1 hour and 30 minutes. Student first pilot time, 32 hours and 25 minutes. And night flying, 15 hours and 25 minutes. So I left advanced and got my wings with 257 hours and 50 minutes. I didn't get too much time at Kingman, but it was in the B-17 Model G, most of it. But I left Kingman with 277 hours and 20 minutes. These are my orders from Kingman back to Lincoln Army Air Base, which of course is only 20 miles from my home. I lucked out there again. Headquarters, Kingman Army Airfield, Kingman, Arizona, 19th of September, 44. Following name officers, Air Corps, have been graduated from co-pilot training. This station are released from attached unassigned section 1-308-3018 Air Force Base Unit and are then assigned and with pay 2nd Air Force C and RP Lincoln Air Force Base, Lincoln, Nebraska, 20th of September, 44, reporting not later than the 26th of September, 44, to CO thereat as members of provisional project as indicated. 2nd Air Force, 16, B-17, co-pilot, 924, Kingman, MOS, 1051. 1051 indicates as a co-pilot. 1091 is first pilot, which I'll get later on. Second lieutenants, unless otherwise indicated. Board D. Clements, 0-784858. I'll add another arrow on this trip from Kingman back to Lincoln, Nebraska. That airplane there is the Queen of the Skies, the one that won the war toughest old bird there was in the air. This one here is the Boeing B-17G Flying Fortress, nicknamed Chucky. This famous World War II bomber was used in experimental electronic research, manufactured in 1944 by Vega, serial number 448543A. Color scheme was done in 486 Bomb Group, stationed in Sudbury, England. You notice the square W on the table. That was tail. That was our bomb group. Engines, four Wright Cyclone GR1820-97s. Wingspan 103 feet 9 inches. Length 74 feet 4 inches. Height 19 feet 1 inch. Maximum gross 65,500 pounds. Those engines were 1,200 horsepower piece, so that was 4,800 horsepower it had. This plane's out of Fort Worth, Texas. This is the Homesick Angel. It was at Offutt Air Force Base in Omaha, but now it's been moved to the Big Sack Museum west of Omaha. It's just about 15 miles from where I live at Elmwood. I was just in this one when they were getting ready to restore it. This is a Sentimental Journey. It's a plane in the Confederate Air Force. These are some Confederate Air Force planes flying in formation. Very loose formation, I might say. This one is a B-25, B-17, B-29, B-24. I'm not sure about that one. These are two B-17s flying in formation. The front one, Texas Raiders. That's in, I think, in the West Texas wing of the Confederate Air Force. And the other one below is the Sentimental Journey, the Confederate Air Force. Did you ever see anything as pretty as those? This is a painting of a B-24 whose name Libra of Zodiac. It was in the 834th Squadron, 486 Bomb Group, Heavy, Station 174, Sudbury, England. This was always the age-old battle of which was the best airplane, the B-24 or the B-17, but I'm sure it was at 17 for where we were at, but Our group went over to England in 24s and then switched to 17, but I'll get into that later when we get to the English part of it. The air base at Lincoln was a great big melting pot for all the Air Force personnel that come in from the gunnery schools and the engineering schools and the radio schools, pilot training, navigator training, and bombardiers, and Some way or another, they had to figure out how to put them together for crews. One thing we did notice, that they never put two guys on the same crew from a real same proximity of their livelihood, because I don't know, I guess they figured, I don't know, they might click together or something, but they were assembled from all over the country. Don't remember much about Lincoln, but I know I don't think I even hardly stayed out there. We had places we could stay, but I spent most of the time at home, but driving back and forth, and most of the information would come up on the bulletin boards and what you had to do, but mainly it was a case of waiting around for your crew assignments. We got in there the 28th of September and left about the 26th of October. In my mind, it wasn't that long, but I guess the figures don't lie here. And start out with the crew here. This is Big Slim Hokum, we called him. He was from Texas, and he was our flight engineer, and he's also the upper turret gunner. And he was his area was right behind us. That upper turret was right behind us, and then he'd help us a lot with problems we had. And oh, he had a little job of calling out airspeed and stuff when we were landing. Next one is Jim Wisely. He just passed away this summer, but he was our radio operator and also a waist gunner. This is Don Simmons. He was our armor gunner, and he was the one that armed the bombs and so forth, and checked the bombs before we took off, make sure they were armed. And he would, if we didn't have a bombardier, he would toggle the bombs at the proper time. This one here is Charlie Jones. Oh, Don Simmons was from Iowa. Charlie Jones, he was from Virginia, Clarksville, Virginia. And he was our ball turret gunner, a little guy. It took a little guy to get in there. Ray Przinski. He was our tail gunner, and he was from Minnesota. Rod Hildebrand, he was our other waist gunner, and he was also from Minnesota. I think those were the only two that were from the same state. This Burt Ward, pilot, he was from Wichita, Kansas. Of course, that's me. This is Walt Kelly, our navigator. He was from Baymanette, Alabama. Bob Goodwin is a bombardier, and he was from Salina, Kansas. And Bob Goodwin trained with us, but then he didn't go overseas with us because they started in with Mickey bombing or radar bombing, and the airplane didn't need a bombardier. But we did get a substitute, Bernie Ofiera, and he was from Michigan. He would fly with us when we flew as deputy lead of the group, or deputy lead of the squadron. Then Bernie would go with us. Now zoom in a little bit closer on these. That's Big Slim Hokum, Jim Wisely, Don Simmons, Charlie Jones. Went to visit him a couple years ago in Virginia, and he's in pretty tough shape. Ray Przinski and Rod Hildebrand. Burt Ward, myself. Walt Kelly. Bob Goodwin. This photograph was taken at Alexander, Louisiana, where we're headed for next from Lincoln. Well, here we are back on the map again. went from Lincoln down to Alexandria, Louisiana. This is a copy of our orders from headquarters, Lincoln Army Airfield, Lincoln, Nebraska, 24th of October, 44. Following officers, enlisted men, and so forth are signed to Alexandria, Louisiana, with pay, on or about the 26th of October, 44. Reporting upon arrival to the CO for duty. And it lists all the crews that were sent there at that time. This is our crew right here. And at that time we were assigned crew number 9367, which would hang with us for the rest of our tour. This is a booklet I got from Alexandria. This is where we took our crew training, and we went through all the process of a mission, and that's what we learned there. Everybody learned his own job here at Alexandria. This booklet has quite a bit of information on what we did there and what we did to learn to fly as a crew. This one here is the Celestial Navigation Trainer. That would be Kelly, and that would be a pilot. And that was one of the trainers we went through there, training for him and for us both. This was a trainer for a bombardier. It was like an ordnance bomb site set up there, and it would move on the floor and simulate regular bombing missions, which give him a lot of practice. You heard me talk a lot about the Link Trainer. This was the Link Trainer. It was mounted up on here and all hydraulic, would move. And this was a guy that was recording all your moves down there. It would just plot it out on the ground. And you'd get your grades when you got done. That was a setup for the top turret gunner. And he got practice right there on his gunnery. Because you can't see up above, you see a plane flying over for him to shoot at. That's the chin turret all rigged up there, and there's a guy running it. This guy up here, that's the chin turret, was right under the guy in the airplane. That would have been right in the bubble of the airplane, and he aimed from up there, and that automatically operated that chin turret. Plane flying by there to let him track that. We had a regular briefing there, just like we were going on a mission, and got the maps up ahead of us on the wall there, and same thing we went through in England on the real thing. That's hauling ammunition out for the gunners for all the 50 caliber machine guns. That was the carriers for bringing bombs out to the airplane. Now those are 100-pound practice bombs that we used there. When they hit the ground, they put out a big puff of white flour and stuff so they could mark it, check it from the air and see how close you hit. That's the line of bombers, one of the lines of bombers there at Alexandria. Gunners carrying their ammo on. That's for their 50 caliber machine guns. They're carrying a camera aboard in training. There was a camera loaded in the bottom of the plane, and whenever they tripped the bombs, why, that camera started running, and that showed you exactly how close you came to your targets. It could take pictures of those flower bombs when they hit the ground. That's the radio operator at his desk. You can see some of the radio equipment that he had there. That picture of the waist gunner. And if you notice, on top of it is 50 caliber machine gun, was this camera operated, so they knew how good you did. When you came back, everybody got graded and checked out. And there's the bombardier sitting right up in that bubble. He's got straddling the Norden bomb sight between his legs there. That shows dropping the bombs. Now, those were dropped at a closer interval, but they call that one a tumbler. He got caught in a slipstream or something and it tipped him, and they called him a tumbler. Now, these were triggered at a little bit wider interval or longer interval, but those all came out real nice. That's the navigator at his little table up there in the nose. I guess I didn't mention we did travel by troop train from Lincoln down to Alexandria because there's a large group of us. And that shows a train getting loaded up to head back to Lincoln again right there.
While at Alexandria, it was kind of uneventful, but I'll try to come up with a few things that kind of maybe stuck in my mind a little bit. One thing, there'd be no order to this stuff, but while we were there, I think we were down in class one day and somebody said there was a fire in one of the barracks, BOQ. When we got to be officers, they called them BOQs, but they were still old barracks, bachelor officer quarters. But sure enough, it was our barracks on fire. We run up there and the barracks were built in a H. kind of shape like that. The fire started in the center of it, and our room was clear over in this corner. And of course they kind of let us out to go see it because we said it was our barracks. And the fire was just in this area, and we got over there and they wouldn't let us go in that building. They absolutely wouldn't let us go in. They could have gone in, but they had a door right in the end, right there were our rooms, but they wouldn't let us go in, so we lost every last stitch of clothing and whatever we had was gone. And so that presented quite a problem. I know the night before it burned, I'd been down at the officers' club and they had slot machines there, and I'd hit a jackpot on nickels. And after the fire was all over, we went in and kind of dug around. I come out with a big handful of nickels. That was about the only thing I could save. I believe I found a set of wings off of one of my uniforms, and I still have that set of wings. That really presented a problem for us because the only clothes we had were what we had on. And we went to our PX and they were clear out, and finally we went down to Camp Polk, Louisiana, which was a large place, and we found a uniform, and I think that's where I had my blouse jacket remade into what they call an Eisenhower jacket. They cut off the blouse part of it and shortened it up, and we called them an Eisenhower jacket, but I thought it was a lot neater, flashier thing, and that's what I had. You'll probably show you eventually a picture of that Eisenhower jacket, which I still have. Of course, this was no different than any other place. We got flying checks, and they had check pilots on the base that would give us the checks. And one night, we went up for a night flight. Here come the guy to give us a check, and before we took off, here a Jeep rolled up, and I can't remember if it was a bird colonel or not, but I think it was. And he was the one they sent around to all the different flying, the Air Force bases, and he checked out the check pilots. Well, of course, you know he got on our plane. And we went up, and I got out of the seat, and Bert got the first check ride. And he got through it all right and everything, and then it was my turn. Of course, Bert got out. And of course, then when they gave you a check flight, I rode 90% of the time in training in the right-hand seat. And when I went for the check, well, they'd always put you over in the left-hand seat. Well, that made everything, you just weren't as proficient, I didn't think, because you used to run the throttle with your left hand and the stick or the wheel with your right hand, and it was just opposite when you got on the other side. Well, anyway, I got out, I taxis out and started taking off. I just got off the ground. Of course, both the check pilots were standing, and Bert were all three of them were standing behind me there, and just got off the ground. I was just starting to raise up, pull up the wheels, and this local tax test check pilot, he reached up and pulled three engines on me. Just, you know, the throttles were all there in a quadrant, and he grabbed three of them and pulled them back. And boy, I started through the procedure or the routine for that, and about that time this other guy, the bird colonel, he jumped over there and he grabbed, slammed those throttles back forward again. And if you ever seen an ass chew, and that pilot got one, that check pilot, he says, "Don't you ever do that to anybody, and especially when I'm along," he says, "you know this plane will not fly on one engine on takeoff, especially with the gear down." But he got a chew on it. That kind of shook me too, but we went on through the test, and I felt pretty good because come back in, and we had a little crosswind, and I think I greased in one of the best landings I ever made, and that's what this pilot told me. He says, "That's the best landing I've ever been in a B-17, and that really kind of made my day after all that. Bert and I never did agree on how to land an B-17 in a crosswind. He was from the old school, where you bring them in and put a crab into them, and so you go straight down the runway, and then just at the exact second you kick it out of that crab just before it pays off. Well, that's pretty hard to do in rough crosswinds. Sometimes you get it done and sometimes you don't, but I was taught to cross control, and that way you could fly with one wing down and keep the airplane straight by cross controlling. And then you'd come in and you'd touch one wheel down and then drop the other wheel down and still kept it going straight the whole time. And that way, when you did it the other way, a lot of times you didn't get it kicked out at the right time and you'd hit with it still in the crab, and that was kind of bad news. We did quite a few hours of night flying there. And when we got back from a flight, we'd pull her in, and our crew had to gas it up. The tank truck had come out, and one of our guys had to get up there and on the wing and put it in there and get them topped off. One night, Polak, it was Ray Przinski, we called him the Polak, was up there. He wasn't paying too much attention. Well, it run over and run down off the wing and onto the ground. And somebody down on the ground says, "Mister," he says, "watch what you're doing." And we had good discipline in our crew, but we were a tight-knit crew and we did things our own way. And Polak thought it was Bert or I. And he said, "Why don't you jump up here and bite my ass?" He said. Well, it was the base commander. He was in his little Jeep running around and checking things, what we did when we come in from a night flight. Needless to say, poor old Polak was down off of that wing, backed up against the plane, getting reamed out. And took Bert and I quite a bit of explaining to get him out of that one, that what kind of a crew we were, and we assured him that he thought it didn't had no idea who it was, but we got him out of it. But that's been a standing joke for a long time. We did like quite a few navigation flights to give a navigator practice. We'd tie them in with bombing, practice bombing runs. They'd have a target out in the middle of nowhere, a big cross down on the ground, and the bombardier would have to zero in on it and drop the 100-pound flower bombs and see how he did. And of course, they were recorded. And we'd do the same thing at night, except rather than have a cross down there, it would be a cross of lights out in the middle of nowhere. Well, one day, we got a shipment into the base. Here was about 300 or 400 hundred-pound bombs that somebody had crated up and sent them in. Well, it was some little town, and one of the bombardiers mistook that little town, the main crossing in town, as the target. And he did a good job. He put them right down the main drag. Nobody got hurt, but they had some flower bombs that they packed up and sent back. We didn't always go exactly where we were supposed to on navigation trips. Kelly was a good navigator, so it wasn't too awful far from his hometown of Baymanette, Alabama. And so he said, let's go to the Baymanette one day, and we did. He got a thrill out of that, flying over his hometown. We went pretty fairly low altitude, and be darned if there wasn't a big pile of smoke coming out of there. And we went down, there was a house burning in his hometown, and we buzzed around there for a while, and he thought that was a good deal. I kind of remember one night we flew over in the Dallas-Fort Worth area and Galveston. I kind of remember one thing is we always kind of wondered, we see these fires burning all over, and it was gas or oil wells, and they were burning the gas off of them or something, but those really stuck out like a sore thumb, was all scattered all over everywhere. Dallas and Fort Worth was really lit up, and the cities, and then you could see the big feeder highways between them with lights all connected to them, and that was kind of impressive for some young kids to see. And Alexandria, it was just another town. We went in there some, but there's kind of one place a lot of us hung out that was called the Club Almack. And when we got to England, we found some old boards and cut them up and named our barracks over there, our hut over there. We put Club Almack up over the door. Another rude awakening I got there at Alexandria. At dark, the colored folks were not allowed in part of the town, and boy, they were not supposed to be there. They were where they belonged. But I think we were in a taxi one night, and we were in a good part of the town, and we saw all these police cars, and they had kind of like a big paddy wagon, and they told them to stop, and we kind of watched what was going on. Well, they cops pulled out about 4 or 5 young black gentlemen, and what I mean, they brought them out with their hands handcuffed behind them, and they brought them up to this paddy wagon, and what I mean, they slammed them down in that paddy wagon face first. And that was really a rude awakening to a kid from the Midwest to see what was going on down there, but it was going on. They rode in the back of the buses and everything. There is no doubt about it. When we were taking just navigation flights and stuff, we did fly out over the ocean and the Gulf. I met the Gulf and down in there, and that was something for us to see too. And we thought we was really seeing the world. And of course, we had some gunnery flights there too. But we did everything that we were going to run into in combat there at Louisiana, we thought anyway. Guess that's all I can think of right now. But from there, they shipped us back to Lincoln, get for preparation to be sent overseas. I'll add another arrow back on that leg of our journey. Back to Lincoln. This is a copy of our orders shipping us from Alexandria, Louisiana, 15th of January, 1945. So-and-so to arrive in Lincoln at 20th of January, 45.
there's a list of our crew. Now here's where we lost Bob Goodwin, the bombardier. They dropped him off of our crew right here when they sent us back to Lincoln. Those are listed in there as second lieutenant, 1091 rating is Burton D. Ward, first pilot. Second lieutenant Boyd Clements is a 1051 rating, second pilot. Second lieutenant Walt Kelly, navigator. James Holcomb, engineer, he's a corporal. James Wisely, a corporal, radio operator. Don Simmons, corporal, armor gunner. Charlie Jones, corporal, gunner. Rod Hildebrand, corporal, a gunner. And Ray Przinski, corporal, is a gunner. Guess that's the first place I've noticed where it's given their ranks. Okay, on flying hours, we left Alexandria, and I had 428 hours and 5 minutes. Got a little more flying down there. I'm not sure, but I think I had this picture taken when I was at Alexandria and sent home. I think this picture was taken at Alexandria, and I think it was taken at the Club Almack that I mentioned before. Of course, this is me, and this is a kid from Omaha, Don Knott, and this is Walt Kelly, a navigator. Here's a newspaper clipping I just found. I guess it got misfiled, but it should have been in the Kingman portion of this tape. Lieutenant R.A. Davis missing on plane. Lieutenant Richard A. Davis, co-pilot on a B-17 based at Kingman, Arizona, has been reported missing on a plane in Arizona since early Tuesday morning. The War Department notified his mother, Mrs. Henry Worley Worcester, 3326 R Street. Lieutenant Davis was a passenger on the missing plane. Searching parties were still hunting for the plane Wednesday. His wife, the former Betty Nash, is living with her parents. Mr. and Mrs. W. Ellis Nash, Jr., 1545 South 26th Street. Lieutenant Davis, a graduate of Lincoln High, where he was a member of the track team, enlisted in the Air Corps March 28, 43, and received his wings June 27th this year. He went to Kingman August 16th. Well, after we got all checked out at Lincoln and our teeth all fixed up and repaired, and I guess we were off to fight the battles, but we left there by troop train and headed to Camp Kilmer, New Jersey. Lincoln to Camp Kilmer. It was right near New York. Well, I got this map up here. I'm going to show you where Charlie Jones lived. Right down in here in the hills in Virginia. And he was our ball turret gunner. You can see the proximity there from where we were at Camp Kilmer. Well, we'll start out again. Well, wait a minute here. Gotta get my hat on.
We have a little condo on South Padre Island right on the beach here, and that's where I've been working on this. I brought a bunch of box full of this old records I've been sorting through, and I've been working on this, and I got a couple next door to me from Cedar Rapids, Iowa, and he's a World War history nut, and so he's been kind of interested, and he and his wife been critiquing this thing as I go along, and they haven't had too much to say about it, except they said, be sure and wear your hat. He says it looks a lot better, you look a lot better because it covers up your old worn, wrinkly face. And so that's what I just remembered. I sat down there and saw I didn't have it on. So, anyway. We took the train to Camp Kilmer, New Jersey. And that was kind of a ho-hum place. We were just sitting around to be shipped overseas. But the good part of it was we got to go into New York City several times. And that was a lot of fun for the country boys. Went up some of the tall buildings and went in a lot of the big fancy hotels, just looking around in Times Square and Radio City. And of course, there was a lot of people there and a lot of war people, and boy, Times Square would be crowded. You couldn't believe it, but it was a lot of fun. And went into a drugstore one night and was having a soda or a malt something, and I got talking to a couple of young gals there, and they said that they sang a little bit with Woody Herman. They knew him real well, and I says, yeah, sure, but they took me over where he was playing. I can't remember, some ballroom there, and they introduced me to him, but they knew him, but they said they just got to sing with him now and then. Yeah, eventually we got our orders to ship out, I remember, and we went by bus. But a little incident happened that Bert and I didn't know about until after we were on the ship. Charlie Jones, our ball turret gunner, he was a little homesick, and we got to Camp Kilmer, and he lived, I showed you, down there at Clarksville, Virginia. Now, I'll be darned if he didn't take off and hitchhiked his way down there. And he came in, the guy said that the enlisted man said he came in the back door of the barracks we were staying in when they were going out the front door, shipping out, and he came that close to being AWOL, but they never even told us about it. Of course, they stayed in different barracks than we did, but that was a close one for him and all of us, I guess. I can't tell you much about where we boarded or anything, but it had to be in the New York Harbor area there someplace, because we went in at night and loaded up at night, and then we were on our way by that morning, next morning. But we went over on the Mauritania. It was the third largest passenger vessel on it was floating at that time, and it was quite a ship. We had about 8,500 troops on there. Of course, there was all kinds of troops going over. The officers got to stay in the staterooms upstairs, and enlisted men were all down, I don't know how many, six or seven or eight floor decks down. And we had showers up there, or no, we had a tub, that's right, because they had pursers on board, and they were watching their water supply, of course, so when we told them we wanted a bath, they would go draw our bath for us, and we'd go take our bath, and that was it. But the poor enlisted man down in the bottom, boy, they had it rough. Each of the officers assigned duty to have to spend so much time down there, and for some reason I got left off the roster. The guys kept threatening me that they were going to tell them that wasn't having to go down there, but they never did. But anyway, I did go down a couple times, and that was really bad news. They were all seasick. They were in hammocks, just probably 6 inches between, stacked up on hammocks between them. And practically all of them were sick down there. I suppose one got sick, and then they all got sick. But boy, you could get smelled. You could skate from one end of that thing to the other. It was bad. I don't think I'd have lived through that, but it was bad. All our enlisted men were, well, all of us were issued 45 revolvers that we carried on missions with us. But all enlisted men, I don't know, somebody said, by gosh, they had all their barracks bags stacked probably in one area. But somebody said, well, gosh, my 45's gone. And they started looking and everybody checked. All their 45's were gone, but a lot of the ground pounders, we had thousands of ground pounders on there, and they found that out. And they were, systematically, they went through all the barracks bags and got all the pistols out of them. And had a big to-do about it, so they had a big shakedown. They didn't find one pistol, so the guys didn't want to get caught with them, so they all must have gone out the portholes and down in the ocean. That was really a waste. Too bad that happened, but it did. Oh yeah, getting back to the baths, we'd sneak one of our enlisted men up, get him in our stateroom, get him undressed, and then one of us would go tell him we wanted to have a bath, and they'd give us a towel, and we'd go in and give it to our enlisted man, and he'd go take a bath then, and back they couldn't tell whether we were the officers or not without any clothes on, so we got most of them, I think, because I remember most of them at least one bath on the way over. I think if I remember right, we were on the ocean about 9 days. Seemed like an awfully long time, but we took a route. We went out in the Atlantic and then headed way south and then across and then over by Africa and up by the Mediterranean, up that way. They said that way they could avoid the submarines. The submarines were all waiting out in front of all around England, and that way we made it without any mishaps. We did have all kinds of drills where they have to get all the troops up on the deck and everything. Of course, we had to go through all the lifeboat drills and all that stuff, but thank goodness we didn't have to use it. We landed at, let's see, get before that. One other little event I remember, I had my 20th birthday, the 20th of February, and on the way over to England, so I thought I was really a man then. I was 20 years old. We landed at Liverpool, England, that's up north, and then we were bused down to our air base. I think maybe we stayed overnight there, and we landed, and then we were bused down to Sudbury, England, 486 Bomb Group, 833rd Bomb Squadron, and called it that air base station 174. I think maybe I'm going to hold on this for a while and maybe finish it up at home, because I've got more material there as far as what we did in England and everything. So hopefully I can get going on and have enough time to do it again at home before too long. So yeah, we're back in Elmwood, hopefully getting ready to go to Padre again pretty soon, but our local church is having another dinner and a service to honor all the veterans of our church and community. They wanted us to bring a lot of, well, just memorabilia, uniforms and so forth, what we'd have during the service. So I got some uniforms and stuff out. I thought I'd just take quick shots of them and put them on this tape. I had a footlocker I put in the attic over 50 years ago. It's been up there probably in 120 degrees and 40 below in the wintertime. I opened it for the first time a couple nights ago, and everything was in relatively pretty good shape. I had to press them up a little bit, but this is my summer uniform. And of course the hat that goes with it. When we got our commission and were flying, all the guys that were flying status, we took the band out of our hats, so we had a crushed look. We had them kind of beat down like we were hot shots, I guess. This is my regular winter blouse. I didn't wear it too much because we all kind of opted for the Eisenhower jacket. We had, we'd buy a blouse like this and then have it cut down, shortened up, and we thought they were more comfortable, and we really liked those. But I still had to have one of these. This one you could wear either with the same green pants, or we had the pinks that were with them. But after the war, I was so hard up, I wore the pinks to live with, so I wore those out. This is the winter cap that goes with it. This goes with the regular blouse and, of course, the Eisenhower jacket also. This is a little better close-up of the summer hat. This is the Eisenhower jacket, we call it. It's a blouse cut down again and tailored to fit. And it was real comfortable. This one has the hardware on it. I did short of hardware for the others. Of course, this is the 8th Air Force shoulder patch. And we wore the U.S. and the wings, little wings and propeller, designated the Army Air Force. There's my sterling silver wings that you get when you get out of pilot training. And let's see. Looking at this backwards, this is a presidential citation the whole group got. This here is a European theater with one star on it. And this is the Air Medal with one oak leaf cluster on it. I don't know whether I had this in Texas and put it on there or not. This is my Air Medal with one oak leaf cluster on it. I mentioned this here while I got it out. This is my brother's blouse. He was in the combat engineers, a second lieutenant. He had 37 men in his platoon, and he was the youngest one of the group. But they really liked him, I guess, from all the stories I heard about it. He was killed in Mindanao, defusing a landmine. Earlier, he was awarded the Silver Star for wading out into a stream and helped and oversaw the building of a bridge, pontoon bridge, to evacuate a bunch of wounded soldiers. Here, this is my brother's Purple Heart medal. And this is a Silver Star medal. This is another jacket I'm kind of proud of. 5 or 6 years ago, the aluminum overcast, that's a B-17 that flies out of the Experimental Aircraft Association at Oshkosh, Wisconsin, was going around the country and giving rides and letting you fly the plane for $500 while you could take the ride and fly the plane for about 20 minutes. All my family and kids and grandkids bought me this ticket, and they said that was my Christmas and birthday present for a couple of years, but I surely enjoyed it. And with the deal, we got this flying jacket, similar to the ones that we use in Europe. I'll take it off, show you the different insignias and what they mean.
this symbol here is of the Experimental Aircraft Association out of Oshkosh. That was the symbol that was on it with my name and name tag and wings. On this shoulder, I put the 8th Air Force patch and the 486 Bomb Group patch that consisted of four squadrons, 832nd, 833rd, 834th, and 835th. I was a member of the 833rd Bomb Squadron of this bomb group, Sudbury, England. And this shoulder is a regular Air Force patch, shoulder patch. And that Heritage Tour of 94 is when it, you know, when it was, when this airplane toured around the country. Okay, the other patch on the front is our 833rd Bomb Squadron insignia. It's called the Bat Out of Hell, holding a 50 caliber machine gun in one claw and a bomb in the other. On the back, a very beautiful embroidered B-17. Very straight. This is back when I fit into these uniforms pretty nice, about 15 pounds lighter than I am now. And this is one of my winter uniforms.